Hey everyone, in this video I'm going to analyze the stock of Abbvie, one of the big pharma companies. If you're new to the channel, my name is Dan. We do a lot of investment analysis on the channel. So if you're into that kind of thing, hit that subscribe button so you can check out my other videos. So Abbvie is a big drug company, and you can look at their website and see they have tons of offerings here. So these companies have many different products. So Abbvie is almost a $200 billion company with a price earnings ratio of about 9.93, which looks very attractive. In addition to that, they have a very nice dividend yield at 5%. Now, as if a 5% dividend yield weren't attractive enough, Abbvie has a record of raising its dividend every year. They've done so for the past 7 years with a 5-year cumulative average growth rate of 20.86%. Okay, now in terms of their revenue by geographical area, they are heavily concentrated in the U.S., as you can see here in blue, with 72% of their revenues coming in the U.S. The remaining 28% of their revenues come from a variety of countries. You got Japan, Germany, Canada, France, Spain, the U.K., and you have this 12% here of all other countries. So there are likely many different countries in that group. Alright, so let's have a look at the balance sheet for Abbvie. I see the liabilities to assets ratio is about 89%, close to 90% there. That's quite high. That means for every dollar of assets, they have 90 cents in liabilities. Very high there. The current ratio is less than 1, just slightly, which means they just barely cannot cover their current liabilities with their current assets. By the way, if you don't know any of these ratios, they're going to be in the description below. The quick ratio is 0.8. I don't like to see that either. And the interest coverage ratio is less than 5. So that ratio tells you, out of your profits for the year before taxes, before interest, how many times can you cover interest expense with those profits? And for Abbvie, it's not too many times. So they're cutting it a little close on a lot of these ratios, and I don't like to see that. If you like the content so far, please don't forget to hit that like button and that subscribe button. Okay, so here I'm looking at income statements for Abbvie for the past 4 years, plus the most recent data we have. We got 2020, we got 3 quarters from 2020, plus last quarter of 2019 for a trailing 12-month measure. Now, what I can see here is a steadily increasing stream of revenue. Well, I should say more than steady. This is going up quite well here from about $25 billion to about $40 billion in 2020. Net income is also going up steadily, although not quite as dramatically, but you can see the increases here. Okay, so what we're looking at here is a vertical analysis where I've taken the 5 income statements and divided every single number by the revenue in that year. So everything is a percent of revenue. So this is nice, and it lets you spot patterns in the data. For example, gross profit is usually 75 or 77% of revenue, which is excellent, by the way. These drug companies have a pretty low cost of actually making the product. One thing I don't like love to see is that in the most recent period, the gross profit is only 68%. It's usually about 76, 77, so that's a pretty steep drop off. For this type of company, you also want to pay attention to the research and development expense. You can see here that has fluctuated greatly, rising to as much as 32% of revenues. And now we're down to about our normal level here, about 15%. I'm going to guess with the most recent pandemic that they have cut back on their spending just a bit, and that may be why that number is a little lower. And finally, if you look at your net income as a percentage of your revenue, that's called net income margin. And what we can see here is that this company generates a pretty good margin on their revenue. But let's have a deeper look at profitability with a Dupont analysis. Okay, so here's a Dupont analysis. If you don't know what this is, check my video out on Dupont analysis in the description below. But essentially, we are taking the return on equity of a company, which is the most important measure of a company's profitability, and we're just dividing it into its 3 parts. So this company has excellent return on equity, averaging close to 100%. The net income margin looks to be around 20%, roughly average, maybe 19% every year. So that means for every dollar of sales, we ultimately keep 18 or 19 cents in profit. The asset turnover is not the best. I mean, you know, for every dollar of assets in place, in the most recent period, we only generated 46 cents of sales revenue. So that's pretty asset intensive. The reason for the very high ROE is our equity multiplier. As I discussed in the balance sheet, this company is highly leveraged. So I love to see their ROE. This is wonderful. I like the net income margin, but you do have to understand that this ROE is largely driven by leverage. Okay, so what I'm looking at right here is the amount of dividends and share buybacks ABBVie has done over the past 5 years. These numbers are all in millions, and you can see in the blue here, you've got dividends. So they have had an impressive streak of dividend growth, as you can see there, going from about $3.2 billion being paid in dividends to 5 years later paying about $6.3 billion. But you've also got a lot of money being pumped back into the company, repurchasing their shares. You're getting that streak of dividends, and you're also in the orange here, you've got share buybacks. Now, it is interesting to note that ABBVie's share buybacks are not very consistent. This could be an indication that they simply buy back shares as a form of paying the shareholders whenever they have extra money available to do so. It also could be opportunistic, in which they're buying shares back when they believe those shares are a good deal. Okay, so to better figure out what ABBVie's doing with these share buybacks, I'm just looking at their price chart for the past 7 years or so. You notice they hardly bought any shares back in 2018, but they bought a ton back in 2019. What's interesting here is that the share price was at all-time lows in 2019. That makes me believe that ABBVie is being very smart about their repurchases. Okay, so here I'm looking at ABBVie's payout and modified payout ratios. Look, the payout ratio is in blue, and that just means what percentage of their annual profits do they pay out as dividends. And as you can see here, they usually pay out about 70% of their profits as dividends. The most recent period, that went up to 86% there, because again, they've had a rough year. Although not as rough as some industries, but they have not had the growth that they normally see. What concerns me here, of course, is their modified payout ratio in orange. The modified payout ratio is the dividends you pay back plus all the money you spend buying your own shares back, all divided by your profits for the year. So that ratio cannot go above 100 for very long, right? That's not sustainable. And that's what I'm concerned about here. You see, for example, in 2019, I know maybe they got a great deal on their shares, but it cost them. And so going forward, they're going to have to stop the share buybacks. Okay, so the next thing I want to do is use a free cash flow to equity model to try and come up with an intrinsic value of a share of ABBVie stock. In order to do this, I need to estimate free cash flow from equity next year. I need to estimate how much it's going to be growing by for the next 5 years, and I need a discount rate. Now, if you haven't seen my video on free cash flow from equity and how to use one of those models, check it out in the description below. But the idea is pretty simple. We're going to say that the value of the company is equal to the stream of cash flows we're going to receive, discounted back to present value. Now, here's the free cash flows to equity for ABBVie for the past 5 years. This should help us predict what they're going to be in the future. One of the major problems with free cash flow to equity, though, is that it is very lumpy. It can really fluctuate from year to year, as you see here. And in the most recent year, ABBVie did some pretty heavy borrowing. As you can see here, I got the net borrowing for ABBVie. They borrowed a lot of money. They borrowed a lot of money in 2019, both years. They leveraged up, they rebought some of their stock, which is great. That's a great move. But, you know, to say that this number is going to be able to continue, no, that's simply not true. So we're going to look at net income as our guide. Net income is an accounting measure. It is much more consistent. And you can see that net income, although it's increasing, it's going to stay in about the same range. So what I've done here to estimate the free cash flow from equity for the following year, I'm going to say it's a three-year average of these 3 years. I'm not going to include the most recent year. I think that is an outlier. So here with ABBVie, the estimated growth rate in net income for the next 5 years is going to be about 5%. And the discount rate, I'm going to go anywhere from 7 to 10%. Now, why so high? Well, you saw from their leverage ratio, they're very highly levered. You got to consider that. They do have some risk of default. And each cell is then going to represent the value of a share of ABBVie, assuming the two conditions, right? So if you look at this cell right here, this says that, hey, if I expect free cash flow from equity to grow at 6%, and I'm using an 8% discount rate, ABBVie would be worth $105.32 per share. So the value can vary widely. I would pay more attention to the values in the middle. I think they're the most likely. I think, you know, these extremes here, that's very optimistic thinking there with the extremely high growth rate and low discount rate. And that's very pessimistic in this corner over here. So what we can see here is that ABBVie is really not a great deal at the moment under most of these scenarios. You can see that in the chart below here, which is highlighted in green if it's a good deal, otherwise it's not highlighted. So in some scenarios, it might be a good deal, but most of them it is not. And it could be quite overvalued here. If you assume their free cash flows from equity can grow at 5%, again, pretty reasonable there. That's what they're forecasting. And you want to use, say, a 9% discount rate. That means they would be currently overvalued by about 23.5%. Okay, here's some insider trading activity, which I always love to look at. Research has shown that when insiders are selling, that's not good for future performance generally. And that's what we see here. We see a lot more sells than buys. When you look at the number of shares involved, it's not a lot in the last 3 months, but certainly hardly anyone's buying there. 7,500 shares bought, over 500,000 shares sold. So overall, you know, it's slightly negative in my view. Okay, everyone. So here are my final thoughts on ABBVie. I don't think it looks like a good buy right now. It has a lot of momentum with it. I know the share price has really gone up in the past 6 months, or even the past month, it's really jumped up. But at the current price level, for anyone that gets in right now, it's just not going to be a good deal. And that's really what's important with investing. You got great companies out there, lots of great companies. We all know what the great companies are we'd love to invest in, but we have to get in at the right price. What I see with ABBVie is a heavy debt load that's really going to hinder them going forward. You're not going to see these share buybacks, so you're not going to see the price appreciation you may have come to get used to with that stock. And it's hard to see how they can keep up their dividend for another 7 years. So I really don't like the look of it right now. You know, maybe they'll come out with some amazing products, some new R&D will turn something up, and you know, I could be proven wrong here. But to me, why take a chance? First rule of investing, don't lose your money. So my recommendation is to stay away from it. That's just my opinion. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. If you did, please hit that like button. Thank you.